This face isn't being prepared for a circus performance. It's grease paint all right, but it's to keep its owner hidden while fighting a deadly serious war in Vietnam. He's Trooper Barry Ainsley of Wollongong, New South Wales, a member of the Army's Elite Special Air Service Regiment. Within an hour, he and a number of others will be dropped into the jungle by helicopter to seek out and spy on the enemy.
We're out doing a job on the 2nd of April. We've just been inserted at 10 to 4. The aircraft had just left the area as we got out. We're running towards the tree line, which is about 50 metres away. And I turned around to watch the tail as the scout was flying his way through into the bush. I saw five enemy come running out of the tree line behind me. They were all very well dressed in green, all carried automatic weapons. The first man had a B-40 rocket launcher. He looked as though he was about to fire it, and I engaged him and the second man with my armor light. I killed both of them, and the other three started immediately returning fire at us. The patrol fanned out into an immediate action drill and returned heavy automatic fire back at them. They retreated back into the tree line, which gave us a breathing space to get into the bush and get into all-round defense. Then we kept taking fire, heavy automatic fire, for about 5 minutes. And it seemed to pause for a while, and I saw another enemy soldier, followed by a lot of movement, run along the edge of the tree line. We opened fire on them again, and they went back in the bush. Meanwhile, they started shooting back again. The bullets were coming in all about 2 or 3 feet high, but we were lying on the ground, so it was pretty scary, but it wasn't too bad at that stage. It seemed to pause for a while, then they started firing again, more automatic fire. By this time, we were trying to call the helicopters back to pull us back out. Having a bit of communications trouble. The SIG was kneeling up, talking into his handset, and another enemy soldier came out of the tree line about 30 metres away from him. He opened fire on him, killing him, and there was more behind them in the bush. We fired back again into the bushes, and then they seemed to swing around more to the left, and they returned fire again. And then it was a bit stale for a while. It was just a sort of a shootout. We were firing back at them, they were firing back at us. And then the gunships came in. And they made their passes from on the north and eastern side of the LZ. And they were taking fire on all their gun runs over us. And we got the message from the slick that said, "We're coming in a few minutes, get ready." The gunship came in again with rockets, suppressed the area. And then we got the word using another radio set that he was on his way in then. We heard the chopper started coming over the tree line, so we got ready and we ran for the chopper. Well, as we started to run, they started shooting at us from the tree line, and one of the chaps took a round through his pants. As we got into the chopper, it was still taking fire. We ran past one of the bodies that was beside us, and as we took off, the door gunner on the right-hand side of the chopper could see two other bodies lying along the edge of the creek. Usually we wouldn't hang around the way we did, but we had to cross a dry creek bed. And from prior experience, we thought that the enemy was trying to push us into the creek bed where they could either assault us from there or have an ambush of some kind. So we just had to stay there and fight it out till we could get the gunships back to pull us out.
I was in the mate's house. We were supposed to do a purely a recce. And in the process of going up to the mate's house, there was numerous amount of shots, about 300 shots altogether, fired around the area. And on this one day, we LUP'd, and there was seven Charlie come across our front about 10 metres away, and then same day, a few hours later, we had two more Charlie about 10 feet from us. All the time there was signal shots within 100 metres. This camp that was presumably there. The whole time they didn't see us, so we had to pull back for the night. When we pulled back, we came back on our same route the next day, and in this process we made contact with an estimated 18 enemy troops. We'd say they were all NVA, and after our contact, which lasted only about 20 seconds, we took off And we got followed up for about 1,600 metres. In the whole process, they would have been about 50 metres away from us all the time, firing signal shots behind us. They were trying to outflank us all the time.
How did you break contact?
Well, we just put a heavy volume of fire at the enemy, and then we worked in two groups and break contact, say, about 200 metres. We ran. We had to run virtually from them. And to break contact finally, we had to bring in the light fire team, the gunships, which dispersed them pretty well.
Well, on Friday the 13th of this year, we went in by armoured personnel carriers, and they dropped us off about 25 yards from the scrub. We went into the scrub about 150 metres, and there was enemy activity in the area. We were stopped and had their comms and had a bit of feed, and they chased us up. Well, they come in close, we seen them, and there was up to a squad or more that we seen, and so we bugged off back about 100 yards to 150 yards and tried to go out to the open again, so we get the APC to pick us up, personnel carriers to pick us up again.
Yeah.
And we got getting near the scrub, and or the outside of the scrub, and we seen there two of them, and I was up the front. Well, I didn't see them, but people at the back, they opened fire, and we ran for the scrub, and as soon as I got out into the open, I seen all the bush on fire, all the open ground. And I think they were just trying to, they seen us when we first went in there, and they knew how many we were, and they were just going to try and burn us out.
Was it a big fire?
Yes, it was. It was about 150 metres away, and ranged about 300-400 yards up and down the north and south it was.
How did you get away?
Oh, we went south for about 400 metres, then they cut by the side of the fire onto the road, and that's where the APCs picked us up after.
They came up and picked you up?
Yes. They were about 8,000 metres down the track. Took them a while to get there, but we got there. We got out. And we got Snoopy in that night, an artillery in the area.
That's the Snoopy is what a...
Oh, it's a plane with miniguns on it.
DC-3 with miniguns.
Yes. And I reckon they made a mess of it. We come out a day or so later.
Thank you.
Right, getting set there for the next patrol?
Yes, sir. It's
going to clean out. All we can do is go up tomorrow, right?
Yes.
Good start. How's it going there?
Outstanding.
How do you find this thing here?
Major Teague, what sort of soldier is the SAS man? Would you say he's ruthless?
Determined, yes. Ruthless, no. He is of above average intelligence, is self-reliant, has adaptability, independence of mind, and the compatibility to work as a member of a close-knit team.
How do the men approach their difficult job?
Very professionally and always with keen enthusiasm. Operationally, they are audacious and determined, but always retaining the ability to improvise and adapt to the situation.
The Special Air Service Regiment has been on operational service continuously since Borneo in 1965, and their courage has been reflected time and again in the honours lists. They are succeeding in their clandestine task in the Vietnam War because, in the words of the motto on their badge, who dares wins. This is Army reporter Bob Cornish in South Vietnam. They are succeeding in their clandestine task in the Vietnam War because, in the words of the motto on their badge, who dares wins. This is Army reporter Bob Cornish in South Vietnam.